beautiful hymns to sing on the day that we have the Lord's table. Cross of Jesus, cross of sorrows. Please take your Bibles and turn with me, if you will, back to that portion of text that we read just a few moments ago in the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 6. Today we're focusing on verses 5 and 6, looking at the fulfillment of the covenant of the land, which is mentioned in verse 4, and then the Abrahamic covenant, which is mentioned in verse 5. It's our 10th week on that series. A very large section of scripture is given to this particular topic. So far we have learned 27 things about the covenant of the land. It used to be called the Palestinian covenant, not a good name in light of what's going on today over in the Middle East. But the covenant of the land, the promises that God gave to Israel as a nation concerning their landed inheritance. And very briefly in review, since last week was our Missionary Sunday with Brother Paul Durand here, I'm going to review very quickly the 27 things, just list them for you, that we have learned thus far, and move on into what the scripture prophesies concerning the future of the nation of Israel. The covenant of the land, number one, sets the conditions by which national Israel originally entered the land. Number two, it set the conditions necessary for them to remain in the land. Number three, it set the conditions necessarily to ultimately inherit the entire scope of the land from the Euphrates River on the east to the Nile River on the west. Number four, God said that the land is for them an everlasting possession. Number five, the covenant guarantees that when Israel is expelled because of sin, God holds the land in escrow for them until he irresistibly, and God is an irresistible drawer, until he irresistibly draws them back to the land. Number six, it guarantees that God will bring them back because Jehovah's covenants with Israel cannot be broken. Number seven, the covenant of the land is an unconditional promise that therefore guarantees that Israel will be a nation forever. Many times God says you will be a nation forever. The covenant of the land guarantees that the ultimate fulfillment is totally unconditional. It will be their land forever. Number nine, and we saw many passages dealing with this, it is a prophetic covenant. Number 10, God always fulfills prophecy literally, specifically, naturally, visibly, and physically. Every promise that you see that has been fulfilled has always been fulfilled in that way. Number 11, because future promises to Israel are prophetic, and this is an important point, because the future promises to Israel are prophetic, denial of the literal interpretation of prophecy is an attack on the inspiration of Scripture. Be careful. There are many who deny those promises, who think that they hold to inspiration, but they are denying the inspired Word of God. Number 12, believing prophetic truth, and this is most important, believing prophetic truth results in holy living. To believe prophetic truth results in holy living. The Bible says, every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Number 13, God said that Israel would be cast out of the land because of sin, and that has occurred three times, and we've had two restorations thus far. The third one is in progress. Israel will be fully restored to the land upon repentance. Partial restoration is in progress, but there will not come a full restoration until Israel as a nation repents, and we're going to spend some time on that. Number 15, repentance must come before Messiah sets up his millennial kingdom. That was the essence of the message of John the Baptist, repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Number 16, repentance before the kingdom was also the message of Jesus after Herod arrested John and killed him. Number 17, repentance before the kingdom was also the message Jesus told the disciples to preach, and we saw many passages on that. Number 18, the message of repentance is the key to the covenant of the land, and we'll spend some time on that today. Number 19, God will use the great tribulation, that is the time of Jacob's trouble, known as the time of Jacob's sorrow, to bring the national Israel to repentance. And that is stated both in the Old Testament, in the Gospels, and in the epistles. We've seen many verses on that. Number 20, this promise includes both halves of the divided kingdom, both Israel, the northern kingdom, and Judah, the southern kingdom. And we saw how the Old Testament scriptures, where sometimes it's being written to Israel, it speaks of Israel. When it's being written to Judah, it speaks of Judah. Paul uses the repentance of Israel as a nation to prove the elective purposes of God. They give us a visible illustration of the sovereign grace of God and the doctrine of election. Number 22. God sovereignly ordained the temporary fall of Israel to open the door for the Gentile salvation and to bring Israel to repentance. Number 23. The church does not replace Israel. The church does not become Israel. The church is merely grafted into the root, according to Romans chapters 9 through 11. Israel as a nation will be regrafted into the root when Israel, which is currently broken off, as a nation repents. The church and Israel are two separate branches that are grafted into the same root of the Messiah, Romans 9 through 11. Number 24, Israel's national repentance and salvation comes at the end of the seven-year Great Tribulation. Number 25, during the final 3 days of the tribulation, God will open their eyes. They will repent and they will return to the Lord. Number 26, the chastening of Israel, and they've gone through a lot of it, the chastening of Israel is proof of three things. Number one, the chastening of Israel is proof of God's love. Number two, the chastening of Israel is proof of God's election. Number three, the chastening of Israel is proof of God's guarantee of repentance. Romans 11, 28, as concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. Hebrews 12, 5 and 6, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. 27, chastening is designed to remove three bad attitudes in the people of God. And that includes both Israel and the church. Chastening is a major theme of the entire Bible because the Bible is God's word to a sinful people. There are three bad attitudes also that God must deal with because God loves Israel. And that is why he chastens them until they repent. God chastens recalcitrant children. God himself said that Israel is number one, rebellious. Number two, stubborn. Number three, a stiff-necked people. And we've talked about those three words, so I'll only say a word or two about them. That's not what I said about the Jews. That's what God said, and he still loves them. Be glad, because you and I are rebellious, stubborn, and stiff-necked also on many occasions. And he still loves us. Stiff-necked means bull-headed, won't bow the head in submission, holds the head up in pride, pulls back the neck, the head in defiance when given instruction or when those in authority try to give gentle guidance. And the Lord said unto Moses, Exodus 32, 9, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. It was the word that Stephen used in his sermon in Acts chapter 7 when he was speaking before the Sanhedrin, and when they finally got angry with him and stoned him, Stephen said, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. Stubborn. Stubbornness is one of the great chief manifestations of pride, of self-will, of refusal to submit to authority. Stubbornness is insistence on personal opinion and judgment over the authority of others. Stubbornness is obstinate refusal to admit wrong even in the face of overwhelming evidence and the proof of error. Stubbornness is a lack of submission, rejection of the principle of obedience. Stubbornness is a precursor to moral defection, very clear in Scripture. When you are stubborn, you end up falling into moral sin. In the Bible, it's given as an external manifestation of the hardening of the heart against God. Judges 2:19, and it came to pass when the judge was dead that they returned and corrupted themselves more than their fathers in following other gods to serve them and to bow down to them and to cease not from their own doings nor from their stubborn ways. Psalm 78:8, that they might not be as their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that set not their heart aright and whose spirit was not steadfast with God. Third word, rebellious. That's the point at which internal stubbornness breaks through the surface and actively seeks to overthrow those in authority. Rebellion taunts authority with the question, so what are you going to do about it? Rebellion is a challenge to the power, authority, good judgment, integrity, moral rectitude, and peacekeeping ability of the one in authority. Rebellion does not contain itself merely to the individual, but actively seeks to gather followers and support to overthrow those who are in authority. Deuteronomy 9:7. Remember and forget not how thou provokest the Lord thy God to wrath in the wilderness. From the day that thou didst depart out of the land of Egypt until you came unto this place, ye have been rebellious against the Lord. It's Moses speaking to Israel. God has delivered them from Egypt, crossed the Red Sea, brought them through the wilderness for 40 years. They're about to go into the land. And Moses reminds them of their rebellious nature. Chapter 9, verse 24, ye have been rebellious against the Lord from the day that I knew you. Not something that developed over a long period of time. It was there from the very beginning. Deuteronomy 31, 27, for I know thy rebellion and thy stiff-necked. Behold, while I am yet alive with you this day, ye have been rebellious against the Lord, and how much more after my death. And God still loved them. Dear people, that's the difference between genuine love and passing affection. Love is a matter of choice. And with God, it's a matter of sovereign choice. God chose us not because we were good, not because we were the most compliant people, not because there was anything righteous in us. He chose us to bring Himself glory and to demonstrate that He can take the worst possible material and make something out of it. Paul explains that in 1 Corinthians. It's not the wise, it's not the mighty, it's not the noble of this earth, but God has chosen the base things, the garbage, if you will, to bring glory to Himself. Are you here today? Do you know Christ? It was not because you were good. It was because you were so bad that someone would say there is nothing that anyone could do with that man or that woman or that boy or that girl. And God said, let me show you what I can do. Like God said of Pharaoh. In our text today, He said, now will I show Pharaoh what I will do. I am the Lord. That is the God we worship. That is the God before whom we fall in humility. Oh, if there's any arrogance, if there's any pride in your heart, get rid of it. For the sovereign God reached down into the slime pit of hell and pulled you out. And it is by the blood of His Son and the washing of the water of His Word that you have been cleansed. Nothing that I have done. It is all the cross of Christ. There are practical consequences for rebellion. Psalm 68:6. God setteth the solitary in families. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains, but the rebellious dwell in a dry land. But God still offers mercy to the rebellious. Psalm 68:18, 12 verses later. Thou hast ascended on high, thou hast led captivity captive. Speaking of Christ, quoted in Ephesians, thou hast received gifts from men. Yea, for the rebellious also, that the Lord God might dwell among them. Isaiah 65:2, I have spread out my hands all the day unto a rebellious people, which walketh in a way that was not good after their own thoughts. God still stretches out his hands. God's design is to break the intergenerational cycle of rebellion from fathers to sons, to grandsons, to great-grandsons, and so on. God will break that cycle. Psalm 78:8, and might not be as their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that set not their hearts aright and whose spirit was not steadfast with God. Rebellious leaders produce a rebellious people, that is, leaders who do not follow what God requires in the Word of God. Isaiah 1:23, thy princes are rebellious and companions of thieves. Everyone loveth gifts and followeth after rewards. They judge not the fatherless, neither doth the cause of the widow come unto them. Rebellion results in bad advice to their own destruction. Isaiah 30, verse 1, woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that take counsel, but not of me, and that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin. 65:2, I have spread out my hands to a rebellious people. Rebellion produces lies, like the devil, the father of lies. It produces law-breaking. Isaiah 30, verse 9, that this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not hear the law of the Lord. But there's a promise. If you flee from rebellion, if you abhor rebellion, God will give you understanding. Isaiah 50, verse 5, the Lord God hath opened mine ear, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away back. Rebellion, like all sin, begins in the heart. Jeremiah 5:23, but this people hath a revolting and a rebellious heart. They are revolted and gone. And James explains that to us in James 1:14-15. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Rebellion is a serious issue in the eyes of God. Ezekiel has more to say about rebellion of Israel than any of the other Old Testament prophets. Israel started the rebellion in the days of Moses, 1445 B.C. at the Exodus, all the way down to the days of Ezekiel, 597 B.C., and the second deportation into captivity. Rebellion for more than 900 years going on during that period of time. The first deportation was 605 B.C., second deportation 597 B.C., final destruction of Jerusalem 586 B.C., 900 years they had been rebellious before they were finally carried off into Babylon. Ezekiel says in Ezekiel 2:3, and he said unto me, Son of man, I send thee to the children of Israel, to a rebellious nation that hath rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me, even unto this very day. That brings us to new material. Rebellion or submission is a choice for which we are held accountable. We cannot blame God. God is sovereign. Not a sparrow falls without your father, and that's not just without your father's knowledge. It doesn't say that. It says without your father. That is, God is in control of the fall of every sparrow. The hairs of your head are numbered. You have more today or less today than you had yesterday. And he knows how many on every head of all the billions of people on earth today and that have ever lived on earth. He knows every cell in your body. He knows every atom in your being. Because he made you. And yet he holds you accountable. How do we reconcile those things? The absolute sovereignty of God in all things. The full accountability of man. God can put that together. It's an infinite concept, just like the Trinity. What you and I need to understand is we can't blame God. Shall the pot say to the potter, why have you made me thus? Romans chapter 9. We look and we say, you are the sovereign Lord. I worship you and I adore you. And we say, you have commanded me to do this and this and this, and you have forbidden me from doing this and this. And because I am related to you by love, you have drawn me with bands of love, with the cords of a man. You have drawn me to yourself, and because I love you, I respond to you, and I obey you. Because what you have commanded me is for my good and your glory. We cannot intellectually and rationally explain how those two things tie together, but the Scripture teaches them both. Rebellion or submission is a choice for which we are held accountable. Ezekiel chapter 2, verses 5 through 7. And they, whether they will hear or whether they will forbear, for they are a rebellious house, yet shall know that there hath been a prophet among them. And thou, son of man, be not afraid of them, neither be afraid of their words, though briars and thorns be with thee. And thou dost dwell among scorpions. How would you like to be described as a scorpion? Be not afraid of their words, nor be dismayed at their looks, though they be a rebellious house. And thou shalt speak my words unto them. And here it is again. Whether they will hear or whether they will forbear, for they are most rebellious. Will you hear or will you forbear? Will you listen or will you refuse? Will you obey or will you disobey? For those of us who preach the gospel of Christ, and all of us should be messengers, the issue is not results. The issue for us is obedience in proclaiming the word of God. And it is the word of God that is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Our job is to preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come that they will not endure sound doctrine. Dear friends, will you hear or will you forbear? Failure to preach the truth is rebellion. But thou, son of man, hear what I say unto thee. Be not thou rebellious like that rebellious house. Open thy mouth and eat that I give thee. As an adamant harder than flint have I made thy forehead. Fear them not, neither be dismayed at thy looks, though they be a rebellious house. The issue is not finding a soft place to preach the gospel. The issue is preaching the truth regardless of the opposition. Rebellion results in spiritual blindness. Ezekiel 12:2. Son of man, thou dwellest in the midst of a rebellious house, which have eyes to see and see not. They have ears to hear and hear not, for they are a rebellious house. Jesus spoke of that. He quoted this passage. Eyes to see, but they see not. You see, rebellion brings spiritual blindness. Ears to hear, but they hear not. Rebellion brings spiritual deafness. God gives multiple warnings to the rebellious concerning what will happen to them. He gives an illustration concerning the captivity in Ezekiel chapter 12, verse 3. Therefore, thou son of man, prepare thee stuff for removing, and remove by day in their sight. And thou shalt remove from thy place to another place in their sight. It may be they will consider, though they be a rebellious house. As you know, Ezekiel goes through many pantomimes, whereby he is teaching object lessons as though teaching them to children through the things that he does. He lies on his side for a certain number of days. He cuts off hair and burns it for certain things. And he digs through a wall. He does a bunch of different things that people watch. They know he's a prophet. They say, what is he trying to teach us through this? He's giving object lessons to them like we as parents do with our children. God gave them multiple warnings. Son of man, hath not the house of Israel, the rebellious house, said unto thee, what doest thou? For I am the Lord, I will speak, and the word that I shall speak shall come to pass. It shall no more be prolonged, for in your days, O rebellious house, will I say the word and will perform it, saith the Lord God. Say now to the rebellious house, know ye not what these things mean? Tell them, behold, the king of Babylon is come to Jerusalem, and hath taken the king thereof, and the princes thereof, and led them with him to Babylon. That's the first deportation, 605 B.C. And utter a parable unto the rebellious house. He's coming back, folks, 597 B.C. And say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, set on a pot, and set it on, and also pour water into it. And thou shalt say to the rebellious house, even to the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord God, the house, O ye house of Israel, let it suffice you of all your abominations. God gave them Ezekiel with plenty of object lessons to warn them, more judgment is coming. Now we ask the most important question. After all that study of stubbornness, stiff-neckedness, rebellion, and as you can see, and we've just covered it, scratched the surface on those issues. You see it over and over and over and over and over and over again. Every Old Testament prophet speaks of it. All the way through the books of the law, as we see Israel in rebellion as God is leading them out of the land of Egypt. Now the most important question. Why does God hate it with a passionate hatred when his own people are stiff-necked and stubborn and rebellious? Why does God hate it so much? Why do we see all these prophecies of judgment? Why does God hate it so much? Hear what God said to Saul when he failed to kill all of the Amalekites and save the best of their cattle and sheep, and saved Agag alive, the king. Saul was a hypocrite, pretended that he had fulfilled what God had commanded. He says, oh, we've saved the best to sacrifice to the Lord your God. When Samuel said, what means this bleeding in mine ears? And here's what Samuel said. Here's the answer to the question, why does God hate it when his people are stiff-necked, stubborn, and rebellious? 1 Samuel 15:23. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Iniquity is moral turpitude, moral filth. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath also rejected thee from being king. Saul's dynasty ended at that point. When you reject the word of the Lord, God calls it stubbornness. God calls it rebellion. God says what you have just done is as though you had just participated in demonism, in witchcraft. What you have done is as though you have just partaken of the worst immorality that you can think of, and here in our country you know what that is. God says it's just as though you had gone to Molech and taken your baby and thrown it into his belly and burned it up in fire. Idolatry. When you reject the word of the Lord. You see, stubbornness, being stiff-necked, being rebellious, always leads to the most heinous and vile sins that you can imagine. You say, well, I'm just a little stubborn. No. Stubbornness always leads to that which brings blasphemy against the name of the holy God who has given you his word. I hope that helps us to understand why repentance is the key to the covenant of the land. We haven't left our topic. God had said that he would bring Israel back to the land. Three times he has thrown them out of the land. Twice he has restored them. There is one more restoration yet to take place. But God made it clear in his word to Israel in the Old Testament that the key to coming back in the fullness of blessing would be when they would repent as a nation. And God will chasten them to bring them to repentance. And he uses that last, final, worse than the Holocaust of the Great Tribulation to bring them to that day, whereas Hosea explains to us, as we've studied already, that in 2 days and on the third day, Israel as a nation will repent. They will have nowhere else to turn. Mossad won't help them. The Iron Dome won't help them. Supplies and missiles from America won't help them. Their intelligence, gifts, and skills and training will not help them. All they have left is the Messiah. And they will turn to him and cry out for him, that the fountain of the house of David might be opened unto them. And God will hear their cry as he did in Egypt. And he will say, now will I show Pharaoh what I will do. Dear friends, that's the God we love and we serve. The God who keeps covenant and who cares for his people and who always keeps his word. We need to be sure that we don't get proud and stiff-necked and stubborn, or we'll go through that chastening hand too. Hebrews 12:7. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if, and ho, here is a warning, but if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, we're still sinners, folks. Even after you trust Christ, you've still got the old sin nature. The Holy Spirit is changing your life. He is molding and shaping you into the image of Christ. He is removing all those old ways, but there is still sin in your life. And so you will come under chastening. If ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. The illegitimates don't get chastened. The real sons do. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, and let it rather be healed. That's exactly what Hosea said to Israel. Hosea 6:1, come, let us return unto the Lord, for he hath torn, and he will heal us. He hath smitten, and he will bind us up. One closing thought. How God deals with Israel as an elect group of people gives a visible illustration of how God deals with us as elect individuals, because he loves us and he wants us to be in fellowship with him. Our gracious Heavenly Father, how we thank you once again for your word and for its power. How we thank you, Father, that because you love us, you chasten us, you scourge us. Because through that, you cause the peaceable fruit of righteousness to be exercised in our lives. Through that, you conform us to the image of Christ. Through that, you prove to us that we are your children. Through that, you prove to us we are your sons. Through that, you restore us to fellowship with you. Help us not to be like Israel was, all the way from the day that you called them out of Israel, out of Egypt, into the land, first of wanderings and then the land of promise. And you will yet keep your covenants with them. Help us not to be like they have been, but let us with humble hearts come before you in reverence, with thanksgiving and praise, with an obedient spirit, with an earnest desire to do what is pleasing in your sight, in the power of your Holy Spirit, to the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ, in obedience to your word. And then, Father, be glorified in our lives. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn in preparation for the Lord.